Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Salam and welcome to our latest author evening at IHRC. We're really privileged to have back with us today Katy Sian talking about her latest book, Navigating Institutional Racism in British Universities. Katy is a lecturer in University of New York in sociology and has written various books, many of which she's come to discuss with us here at IHRC. In fact, I think yours was one of the first books we actually discussed when we opened the bookshop. Back now, right? And we're really happy to have you back talking about this particular topic, I think, which is often overlooked but has been simmering for a long time. We can discuss the kind of previous work and the context of your research as well in a second. Your book, which I think has had quite a lot of traction in mainstream media in a way that I was personally surprised but also very happy about. I just wondered if maybe to begin with, you can discuss about some of the reactions to the book, whether it's what you're expecting or whether it's created maybe a little bit of momentum around something that we're going to take for granted and not discuss whether it exists or not, which is institutional racism in British universities.
Okay. Well, first of all, again, thanks for having me. This is my third book that's been launched here, so it's a pleasure to be back. So in terms of the response, I think mainly on social media, I was actually quite shocked at kind of the engagement actually with that, and then of course like mainstream media as well. I do think there has been more momentum because more people have actually been writing on this topic recently, so it kind of caught on the back of that. And I think one thing that I really tried with this book was just to be very kind of straight and honest with it. So I think it is very kind of, as well as being personal, it's also cathartic. It doesn't try to be too academic-y or too complex. It's just about really highlighting a really serious problem. And it's trying to create that urgency around this issue. You know, we've got people who have been working on similar kind of connected issues, so there's a whole new scandal around sexual harassment, for example, in universities. So I think what's happening now is that there's a lot more voices that are adding to this debate. But the sad thing is, with the racism in university debates, this stuff has been well documented now for over kind of 20 years. So I'm not trying to say anything's new at all, or it's worse even, but I think now we've got more voices and more of a platform to actually kind of bring attention to this issue. And so I was really like pleasantly surprised to see that response.
Yeah, it certainly felt following the publication of the book that a lot of people suddenly found it's okay to talk about it and what they've been going through. I mean, quite a lot of academics that I knew who never actually spoken about this and engaged with it. I think that in and of itself has got to be a very positive moment, and I hope that momentum continues.
Yeah, definitely. And I think the whole setup of this book, and you know, people who know my work anyway, it's always about conversations with me. And it was allowing people to speak. I mean, I've talked about that interview process itself as being a conversation for some. You know, it felt like it was a therapy session for them. You know, there were some tears in some of the interviews as well. But following the publication of the book, I've also had private messages to my email, to Twitter and so on, also from different academics at different levels, and actually not just based in the UK, Canada, the US, talking about similar experiences or sharing some awful experiences. So it's great in a way that it's opened that kind of space for people to actually comment or actually just engage and talk about, wow, you know, I feel like, you know, this captured something that I was also experiencing at this place.
Could you just kind of give a very short overview of how you sort of split up the chapters, what kind of key things you found that you were kind of focusing on?
Sure. So the first kind of part of the book is really about context setting. So thinking about the university as kind of like a the space of what it represents, right? So it's often seen as this very liberal, progressive space where, of course, nobody's racist. Of course, we don't discriminate against people and so on. So the first section, actually, in the first couple of pages, is myth busting. So it's saying, kind of, actually, these are the myths that we see, whether it's in university brochures, whether it's from kind of senior academics and so on. But all that culminates in the kind of post-racial, really, and the university has been one of the key institutions, I'd argue, in society that has really perpetuated the post-racial and actually maintained that idea that there's no such thing as racism. And you actually see that structurally because they've gutted anti-racism policies in universities. We don't have any like kind of systematic monitoring. And Sarah Ahmed has been really important for me with this book in the terms of thinking about the way in which actually diversity now has come to is the safe word that we use in universities rather than kind of anti-racism. So it's another way to divert that kind of attention away from racism. So in that environment, what happens is not the racism that we experience on the streets, so the kind of, you know, spitting on us or harassing us, saying things like the blatant forms of racism, is actually the liberal racism, yeah? So it's the microaggressions. And that's really what chapter one deals with, are those subtle forms of racism, the hidden forms that actually, you know, really have them that take such a toll on like people of colour. It's those everyday racisms that really, really kind of make academia so draining for people of colour. So I've gone through a detailed account of the different microaggressions that were the most kind of dominant forms. So it might be kind of simple things like we were just talking earlier about things like being mistaken for the only person of colour. So this has happened to me so many times at every institution, and I look nothing like that other girl of colour in the department, and I've been addressed with that name as well in an email and so on. And I just find that so bizarre, but that just the thing is, it wasn't just unique to me. So all these experiences we all shared across the board. So a lot of people were talking about that. Now, why that kind of grates is because you're at this institution, you're working at this place, but it shows that they can't even be bothered to kind of learn your name. So there's not that level of investment there.
They don't see you.
Yeah, exactly. Another key thing was, picking up on that invisibility, was this interesting paradox between invisibility and hypervisibility. So we're invisibilized at the point of kind of when it comes to promotions or sharing an important platform or having a high status, but we're visibilized when there's a problem or when we talk when we shouldn't talk in a meeting or so on. Or when we seem to cause trouble for raising something. So constantly there's that paradox between being the only person of colour in the institution, so you're very hyper-visible, but then at the same time you're ignored in kind of more, let's say, like the managerial side of things. There was also exoticisation going on, but mainly of women, the women of colour. So from the things what people were wearing, and it was interesting actually how far you go with that. So you'll be exoticised in a way where, oh, it's about jewellery, makeup and so on, but if you then go to the extreme where you're seen as too Asian, for example, so I don't know whether wearing Asian dress or wearing the hijab, then you actually incur some really hot, like actually strangely overtly hostile comments. So somebody noted very slight comments being made directed because she was, you know, overtly, you know, whereas if it's just a case of jewellery and things like that, it's cool, you're cool different. And there was that tension there. And this was mainly on women's bodies, whereas men of colour, and this was kind of both black men, Asian men, Muslim men, were always kind of, they always occupied, they were always seen to, that they should occupy a more subordinate position, and this was mainly enacted by your liberal white feminist women in departments, mainly kind of at senior level as well. So there'd be the typical constructs of male aggressiveness, that they're loud, that they're overly friendly, that they're homophobic, that they're overly religious. So all these things being perpetuated and actually kind of articulated in the more subtle ways by mainly white women, actually, who claim to be, you know, your white liberal feminist. So that wasn't too surprising in a way, because we know the way in which white feminism has always kind of contributed to maintaining systems of white supremacy anyway. But it was interesting to see that how that plays out in academia on male bodies, where they are males of colour are seen to be incompetent. Yeah, so there's a more kind of added sense of scrutiny and surveillance that's reserved for them.
So I mean, in terms of the impact of that, I think you go into quite a lot of detail in a chapter on mental health issues, or even just the mental strain. Let's put it that way.
Completely. So I talk about that again in the throughout the book, really, about the emotional labour and that's attached to this drip-drip day-to-day racism. And that's also picked up, actually, going on to chapter 2 in teaching, which was really interesting because, again, teaching in kind of the ideal form is supposed to be this critical site of engagement where everybody's learning and, you know, it's a safe environment, but actually for people of colour it's not. So again, if we're thinking about, it was weird, again, Muslim male academics, three different people from different universities, all spoke about the way in which they were interrupted. They actually had Islamophobic abuse thrown at them in the middle of the class by students. So remember, this is why I don't want to individualise these accounts either, as, oh, it's just at that university. You know, you've got it widespread. So there's an issue here, it's systemic. And then again, for early career academics of colour, there were definitely tensions around authority, and especially if you're a woman of colour, that, you know, you're not seen as a credible person, you don't deserve to be at the front of that classroom. And I describe this as kind of white lash, right? They don't, especially when people, we will teach more generally on the race courses, it'll tend to be us doing that labour, which is difficult labour because no one can really talk about that properly. And then that brings its own kind of harms as well, because white students don't really want to engage with it. They can be hostile. I mean, sometimes they love it, and when they do, that's great. And this is why kind of I find decolonising the curriculum stuff so important, because when you actually do engage with that literature, a lot of students do like that, but you also do certainly experience white resentment as well in that classroom setting, definitely.
So in terms of, we've gone on to decolonising the curriculum, that seemed to be actually, obviously there's a lot of recommendations that you summarise at the end, but that seemed to be quite a key one coming up from lecturers, basically, and academics. I was just wondering, because we've had that sort of moment now for 5-6 years on this idea of decolonising the curriculum. I think, at least from the kind of public gaze, it's slightly slipped away. Is that, do you think, as you're coming from academia, has it slipped away from the agenda in academia, or is it kind of there, and is it being pushed particularly by the type of people you were
Well, I think it's still there, but I think now something a bit more insidious is happening in the sense that there's a market for it now. So the managers have seen, so it's now becoming co-opted, right? So managers have seen, oh, actually, there's a demand now for this decolonising the curriculum.
That was quick.
But, yeah. And then, so it's become more of a recruitment strategy rather than something actually about social justice. And I think the task for us is how we actually then hijack that and manoeuvre that so it does come to represent actually the more social justice movement that we see as decolonising the curriculum. I think one thing that's still problematic about decolonising the curriculum, again, all the respondents spoke about the way in which it's, again, our labour. So it's us who have to kind of introduce other colleagues to different authors or whatever else. They don't do that. And I always find that really peculiar because I've had to learn every single white theory you could think of, every single area you can think of. But when they're asked to engage with something that they, you know, might not necessarily know inside out, it's a huge task for them. And you see they don't really want to invest with that because that requires work on their behalf. So I think it's good in a way that it's coming. It's been kind of structured a bit more through universities. I don't think it is nearly as far as we want it to be. But I actually argue that I think it needs to come more from the political level, actually. And I think, you know, Jeremy Corbyn's done some really interesting stuff around kind of implementing stuff for like the Emancipation Education Trust and all of this, like his pledges that schools should actually embed different kind of materials that show the contribution that black people have made to history and so on. And I'd like to see that extended to the university so it's actually mandatory and it has to actually come, it has to be there structurally and not just a few of us doing it. And I think that's a positive, well, that could be definitely a positive move, but for the most part it is just coming from our labour. And actually students of colour as well, they're the ones who really mobilised the movement. It wasn't just academics.
Before we talk, I want to talk about, you know, you've got quite a comprehensive list of, a comprehensive list of recommendations based on your interviews. I just wanted to pick up on what you were just talking about. So is it the emancipation?
What's it, emancipation? The education emancipation.
Because it just, you mentioned earlier on about this, the moment that we're in, that universities have kind of gutted equality policy, anti-racist directives, etc. And obviously, you know, the kind of work we've been doing as well, the sort of conversations we've been having with people about where we're at in the UK with regard to quote-unquote old-fashioned term race relations, right? So X amount of people have said, look, we had this kind of epiphany, we had this great moment of lots of great laws and policies and directives on paper. All we need to do is kind of make those work again. Do you think that's something that, you know, okay, let's bring back those directives, let's make sure that they're all implemented? Or is it that we need other things, maybe like the suggestion of Jeremy's, or as we'll discuss a bit further, maybe things that are coming out of the marginalised spaces that we're finding ourselves in?
I mean, I think, yeah, we've definitely had such an important foundation there, kind of from that 70s movement, there was a lot of important kind of interventions made, and then of course we do get the thing where we did racism in the 70s, we did anti-racism in the 70s, 80s, we don't need it anymore. So I think, of course, those policies, etc., that monitoring was far more robust in some senses, actually, in institutions back then. I certainly think that they are very important to re-implement. You know, Ian Law's work actually on building the anti-racist university set out some really significant steps for universities to do that. And I talk about that in the book, 20 years on what's happened. And, you know, universities haven't really kind of implemented that stuff anymore because they don't need to. I do think that stuff needs to be extended, though, as well, because there are new challenges, particularly around mental health. And I think, you know, that needs to be tackled. There are definitely new challenges in terms of the neoliberal kind of marketisation as well. How do we deal with that? How do we deal with fixed-term contracts and so on? So I think it needs to accompany this changing environment, definitely.
So, I mean, the neoliberal university, if you like, is that, if you like, the main culprit or the source? Are we talking about that exacerbating a kind of pre-existing problem at the university?
Yeah, I think it definitely exacerbates and heightens the problem. I think the problem has always been there because I do see the university itself as a fundamentally kind of colonial institution. From the get-go, right? But I think this certainly, the neoliberal has definitely heightened everything and made things a lot more kind of challenging as well. And what we've seen with that is, you know, you've got people of colour, this isn't just people of colour, you've got early career academics of, you know, who were kind of on these fixed-term contracts and so on. But added to that, I did interview a couple of kind of international academics of colour, and they talked about their struggles, and you see how, again, the neoliberal university really just takes advantage of their status as international and their lack of rights. Generally, academics of colour have got it pretty bad in universities, but if you're an international academic, you've got things like sponsorship, you've got kind of various monitoring, and this happens like with students as well, international students. And there's no kind of protections there either. There's no regulations. And I do think that's definitely part of this neoliberal university. The universities are not held to account at all. It's also bred competition, between people of colour, and that's not necessarily healthy, because you see various manoeuvrings where we're not supporting one another, and that again is because of this environment that we're faced within.
So in terms of, before I open it up, the recommendations that you present, well, so we've touched on a few, what are the kind of top 4 or 5 that you think, okay, that's what literally everybody was talking about.
Yeah.
It seems to me a lot of, when people like ourselves read books like this, things seem very obvious, but they're clearly not obvious to the institutions that need to be waking up to the issues, whether they're deliberately blind or just genuinely clueless or a kind of toxic mixture of both.
So I think one of the key things is the underrepresentation problem of academics of colour. So we know it's less than 1% of people are making kind of senior, 1% of BME people are making senior positions in universities. And that's pretty scandalous in 2019. So kind of how we can think about correcting that issue or starting to kind of take the path where we can get a greater representation, I think is through universities really need to be transparent. I think that's a key problem. We don't have much access to the data. I'd like to see retention rates, promotion rates, like on an annual basis, and one of the recommendations is that universities all must report annually on these figures, on targets. Targets need to be set, and if they're failing to meet these targets, that needs to be reviewed. I do think we need an independent review body for kind of all forms of harassment. At the minute, there is some kind of functioning thing around student, I don't know what it is, it's like student rights or something like that, but it's not independent because you've got people like Toby Young on that.
Yeah.
Like, that's not really something that's going to help that. So I want something completely independent from some people that are completely independent to actually intervene on these issues, because a lot of people dealing with harassment just don't know where to go. They've got no support. Unions, unfortunately, have been so kind of stripped back in universities. They're so under-resourced. There's not been as much action on racism and anti-racism that I'd like to see from the union. So I think a support unit would be really important. There are some really simple things as well in terms of having a person of colour on a hiring committee or a promotions committee. Because if you're kind of confronted with an all-white panel, what happens is, and we see again from kind of even like my respondents' experiences and so on, you're less likely to get hired, and the data also shows that. Other things, again, we talked about, like the decolonising the curriculum, that has to be something structural coming from the top. And certainly, I'd like to bring back and see certainly the monitoring again of kind of, you know, like I said in the beginning, like the promotion rates, how many people are we bringing in, why are people not being promoted or progressed, and why are people leaving the whole sector or industry, why are people of colour taking jobs in America, for instance, and kind of leaving the UK. All of these issues need to be monitored and addressed, and I think the main thing behind all of this is putting kind of race back on the agenda. That's one thing that all my respondents called for. We need to talk about these issues in a candid way, and these changes have to be, which is really important for me actually, they have to be structural, not just cosmetic. That's a key thing, because you'll see universities pledging kind of, you know, that they're doing this or this, and it's just, you know, around a diversity event or so on, or brown people in a brochure holding hands, you know, that's the more cosmetic stuff, the easy stuff. That's not tackling any of the structural issues which the book addresses.
I'd like to open it up now so to people online for questions.
I'm in a university where it seems like there's a free liberal approach to a marking system. But I've experienced at my young school, my junior school, where there were some Bangladeshi students who were very much disregarded. This is my school level, coming to the university, were very much disregarded, and their marks were laboured and put down. Now, I wondered whether you realised, you thought of this existing universities where a university student might go into, say, a room of students. You might say have three Chinese students, three Japanese, two British, and say five Bangladeshi, and they'll think the Chinese and the British, aren't, because of their track record, are quite brainy, quite intelligent, big in cognitive strength. So that teacher might relate to them more, give them more time and advice and logic and more professionalism, and expect them to get the good marks and disregard the Bangladeshi children. It does happen. Do you see these kind of things for the marking systems and for marking down assignments, I mean?
So certainly in universities you get that pattern, what you've described, so particular lecturers holding kind of stereotypes about students of colour. And you can see that actually with kind of, again, student retention. Why is it that BME students are actually dropping out more likely than their kind of white counterparts? And, you know, a lot has to do precisely with that dynamic in the classroom and the various kind of assumptions placed on students of colour. I mean, I think you did the launch the other week when people were talking about their experiences as students and the way you are disregarded as well. One thing I found particularly kind of, saddening really is the fact that year upon year, all the very few at my university students of colour often come to my office, even if I'm not like their personal supervisor, from different departments actually, will come just to talk to me about kind of the experiences that they're having, whether that's kind of not being understood by lecturers, whether it's being harassed by fellow students and feeling isolated and so on. And again, it comes back to that one or two academics of colour in a department spotted around the university that ends up doing that labour. And we do that because we care. It's not like a chore or anything, but it just shows kind of that extra invisible labour that we have to do as well.
In terms of, please send me the online questions as well. In terms of, we talked briefly about Ian Law's work from 20 years ago, that was sort of post McPherson. I think some of us naively thought that McPherson would like change the landscape forever, but the pushback was quite intense. Did it ever have any real purchase in academia? I mean, I think we had moments in other institutions where McPherson kind of took some hold, that kind of idea of transforming the institution. I'm not sure, and I think we'd better address to discuss university.
I mean, I think that debate completely was overlooked at the university. It's bar kind of Ian's work on the toolkit, on the anti-racist toolkit, and there wasn't that public discussion. So what we were seeing kind of 20 years ago with the police and even the BBC, their acknowledgement, maybe we're kind of seeing it now by using terms as institutional racism and within the university, but that has not been present whatsoever. And I think that again is a key kind of function of the book, because this is why it ties in with kind of the post-racial logic, is because they've never admitted that there is a problem with racism in universities. You will not find it, and actually on a personal level, like at senior management have said, this university is not institutionally racist. So there's no acceptance or admittance of that. And that's, again, to go back to Sarah Ahmed's work, a lot to do with reputational damage. They just don't want, how will that affect student numbers, how will that affect recruitment cycles and so on, if, oh my gosh, it's exposed that we are institutionally racist. So what you see is attention being paid to those incidents where a student's been racially abused on campus, where it's got loads of media attention, but it's about that one student and about that one perpetrator, for example. So again, we're individualising the problem. So there's not been much of a public debate about the actual institutional nature. And this is really fundamental to the book, because even though this, you know, critics of the book might say, oh, it's just a number of isolated incidents. Well, it's actually not. It's a number of repetitive incidents across the country, which shows that this is something systemic. And I'll never ever say anything kind of positive about the police, but there was a public discussion that the police were institutionally racist, and now kind of that's synonymous, right? There's that acknowledgement there in the public psyche about the police being institutionally racist. We're not there at all with universities, and this to me is the biggest scandal of universities, because so much is being swept under the carpet and hidden, and I think that's becoming quite worrying now.
So two thoughts that come to my mind. You mentioned before, and it goes to this point that, okay, there has to be a political movement to force change in the university, but we're also in a wider political context where, I mean, this morning, this is going to date the video that we'll put online, I mean, Parliament has been prorogated, so it's actually shut down for 5 weeks, okay, in an extraordinary situation. Do you feel that that's really the kind of the only way to go? Because you talk a lot about, and you quote that book's at the outset, I think, that to celebrate that space of marginality that we find ourselves in, actually use that space, that is actually a powerful space. is it maybe something that we need to just, you know, let's forget about the political context and stop looking towards that, or is it a combination of that and also understanding that we can use that sort of space of precarity, if you like, change your energy a bit, or turn it into something?
So I think it's definitely a bit of both, because I think that using that space of marginality is within itself a kind of very political act as well, and informs that wider context actually. I find, you know, in the chapter on kind of resistance, how do we resist and so on, so yeah, there are these structural wider changes that need to be made, but definitely for me, throughout my entire career, a lot of that resistance has come through that space of marginality in terms of the writing, in terms of the documenting, and we can do so much with that. So writing for platforms outside of academia, for example. So I've written a lot for non-academic platforms, and you know, that's really kind of, that helps open up particular debates and reach different audiences, but it also kind of generates a collective as well. And I think also something that's quite nice about the new kind of cohort of BME academic scholars and so on, researchers, is this whole thing on scholar activism. So we're actually taking our research, our work, but we're not just using it for academia, we're actually taking it outside, and we're also learning lessons from outside and bringing that back in. So I think that stuff is certainly, that has a lot to kind of account for in terms of shifting, or at least kind of interrupting that traditional white space.
And just maybe to touch on the political surroundings.
Mm-hmm.
Obviously, there's sort of momentum within the movement that was around Jeremy Corbyn.
Mm-hmm.
But within, and actually also outside the Labour Party, I think, it would be a section of the Labour Party. But I wondered if you found or thought there are other kind of political spaces, not necessarily party political spaces,
mm-hmm.
that thought, okay, those need to be activated, they could be activated, they are already perhaps feeding into what's happening in the university space.
Yeah, I mean, so I think kind of grassrootsy type stuff has always helped in terms of, you know, like, for example, being here in this space, for example, and you hosting, this is like, you know, your second one in kind of a few months on this very thing on like race in education. So I think definitely I'm seeing more of kind of a connection between academics and activists. Sometimes it's fractured, sometimes it's not, but I do think that link is really important to actually then kind of, you know, generate some sort of change. You talked about like Jeremy Corbyn, Labour and so on, and I know that this issue particularly is very important for them, but beyond that, in terms of the wider political landscape, there's an interesting kind of space now that we're occupying, where we also have to be very aware of the stuff that we're producing as well, what's being monitored with our work, for example. And you know, there's been a whole thing of scholars being subjected to Professor Georgiansky in the States being on the government blacklist and so on. The way in which, if we're vocal about prevent, what are the implications for us? So there's all these new kind of navigations and challenges for us within that environment because of the wider context, and you know, a context where far-right rhetoric is just being so normalised as well. That is, you know, of course that's infiltrating within academia. You've got conferences being held with far-right spokespeople, that's happening quite commonly now across university campuses. So Yeah, it's a really interesting, but again, I'd say kind of a worrying space as well at the same time because of those wider political forces.
Yeah, it just came to my mind this, there's been a couple of conferences at least on basic eugenics.
Yeah,
so,
exactly.
So you read that and you think, where did I get
from? Yeah, whereas a conference on Palestine is shut down. So you see the academic space actually as a mirror to the wider kind of geopolitics, really. And I think this is where, for me, the resistance does become so key, whether that's through writing, whether that's through actual organising. I argue that there's not one particular form of resistance that's right or wrong. It can be, you know, an organised movement, whether that's our groups of kind of, you know, academics of colour all coming together and maybe organising, or it can be definitely the documenting and the writing, which, you know, for me has been really important, or it can just be a conversation of sharing. And I think that's equally as important, having somebody to speak to and actually sharing that. And you, just by being in that space together, is also to kind of undermine that toxic form of whiteness.
Thanks for that, Katy. Really illuminating talk. So I'm just thinking about whether we need to work on unsettling the concept of institutional racism. And taking it less for granted, because when McPherson used the concept, he explicitly said that if you think that by me using the concept of institutional racism, I'm talking about the police's policies and the laws and the official procedures being racist, you're wrong. They're not racist at the level of policy and at the level of official procedure. And then his definition has subsequently reduced the idea of institutional racism to attitudes, behaviours and kind of the individual. And then over the last 20 years, like you kind of mentioned, that it's been discussed in the mainstream and so on. But the discussion has capitulated to those individualized logics and those neoliberal logics, actually. You had Cressida Dick come out and say recently that institutional racism isn't a useful concept. So I'm just thinking whether we need to kind of go back to that debate and actually situate that idea in terms of when we talk about institutional racism, we're not attacking individuals, we're not attacking individual managers and so on and so forth. It's actually the systematic way in which the university works, and reground that concept.
Yeah, certainly. So I do actually provide a critique of McPherson on precisely those grounds, because actually McPherson ends up paradoxically undermining the concept of institutional racism, precisely what you've said, because it reduces it down to kind of attitudes and biases and so on. So I'm much more kind of old school in that sense, in terms of it being a Carmichael definition, and also thinking about it through Barna Hesse's work has been really important, and thinking about racial governmentality and so on. I think certainly the concept itself has had that loosening due to kind of McPherson, but I'm not also of the opinion of kind of abandoning concepts either, whether it's racism, Islamophobia and so on, because I think there's been so much debate already invested in these terms and concepts that it's actually up to us to then reclaim them to actually make sense to what we kind of mean, or kind of come to mean what we want them to mean. So it's about really reclaiming that knowledge back.
You spoke about universities wanting to sort of brush instances of what you say is institutional racism under the carpet. Oftentimes that's been easier to do because there's been no formalized networks of BME academics talking to each other. In an era of social media where people are more apt to discuss their experiences in a public sphere, I'm wondering, how do universities respond to those? It doesn't seem to be mostly ECRs that are more willing to speak up, or do they still bear the wrath of the institutions, and how are those institutional structures responding to people more discussing things in more democratic spaces?
So I think they go into panic mode. mind is the first thing, because again, it's this whole thing of reputation. So I remember kind of less so again academics, but more when a student was harassed on campus, you know, when it blew up, and there's it just panic with the university, and then all the kind of we are committed to, you know, anti-racism, diversity, and making our students feel safe on campus and so on. With academics, you've definitely seen again with the sexual harassment scandal, there's been more talk from senior managers, but again, it's the same kind of lip service rather than a commitment to the structural change. But I think in terms of racism, what's been interesting about social media is that sharing actually and that collectivity. So like I've said, even with this, so many people ended up sharing their own experiences. With this book, however, it was less so kind of at the higher levels who were likely to engage with it. It was more kind of like early career researchers or kind of, you know, maybe some senior academics, but no kind of, let's say, white manager level didn't really want to kind of engage very much with that, which is to be expected, because, again, why a university is going to declare that there is a problem within their university and so on. Now, who's coming forward is interesting. So I interviewed people for this book from all different career levels. So it was early careers, it was people on fixed-term contracts, research contracts, professors, the readers and so on. So there's a real mix there. And I think, you know, there's a lot more, I don't know, there could be seen to be a lot more risk for early career researchers to do that. They've got their jobs, their careers to think about. You know, at the same time, professors or more senior people of colour, they at the same time also have their career to think about. And I think it's what I argue in the book on the kind of resistance chapter is it's up to that person to decide what they can do in their capacity. Like, don't put yourself in a position where you're not supported already. Don't kind of make that position worse if it's not going to help you, but do share and speak to someone that you can trust in and so on. If you're feeling more brave, great, go ahead, document and so on. But I think it's up to the individual to really decide like where they are and if it's kind of worth the risk or not.
So, moving on to your concluding thoughts, I was quite touched by the journey you felt, you described you've been on, because obviously it's a very personal one as well.
Mm-hmm.
Do you want to maybe just elaborate a little bit on what you went through, but also your concluding hopeful thoughts?
Yeah, so I think, like, I'm 10 years now out of my PhD, which seems a really long time. I feel like I've aged so much in academia. I think at the beginning, when you look back, you are so kind of caught up in that idea of, wow, you know, academia, you can actually transform the world. And, you know, it is this space where everybody is collegiate and everybody is supportive. And then you go along and then you see it couldn't be farther from that truth, actually, and you actually have to really develop a thick skin. I think that's one thing I've learned. I have been really blessed with some exceptional mentoring, and I think there was a sadness in the book that a lot of my the people that I'd interviewed had not had that same level of mentoring. I was so lucky because my mentoring still continues to this day, actually, and through that I was taught so much about how actually to be a generous scholar, how to kind of support people, how to understand the situations that we find ourselves within, how to also kind of just generally be a good scholar. And I think that really sheltered me from that neoliberal kind of, oh, it's about publications, or it's about, you know, research grants and so on. It's about throwing your peer under the bus. I was really kind of socialised out of all of that. And I think from the responses in my book, that's something that has, that's the main thing that has helped me survive academia. And, you know, those other friends, those other academic friends who, you know, whether it's people in Portugal that we might know, for example, who've been exceptional, or people in Canada. So it's interesting that a lot of my support has not actually come from the institution itself. It's always from these external places. Mm-hmm. But those conversations and those relations have really helped me throughout that 10 years to develop kind of the voice that I have developed, and made me just be fearless. Because I think what happens, and what I see again in these interviews, is that we still naturally, there's a fear about kind of working within that institution, what will my boss think, and so on and so on. And sometimes I still have that, but I think as you grow, you develop that fearlessness. Yeah, and that spirit to be brave. And the journey has been rewarding as well at the same time. Like, there's been definite high points, you know, whether, and I'll always say for me, the high points is through that space that I'm allowed to be creative with my writing. Again, I think that's something that's massively saved me as well. Because I just love doing the anti-racist stuff, making those connections, but also documenting that work. So I think the space has been really great for that. And I think kind of in terms of the hope, you know, I mean we mentioned like the end. I do look at Nina Simone's journey. Mm-hmm. So that was so important and still remains so important for me when you get those down days, like, why am I still doing this? Why am I actually putting myself through all of this? And you actually see that, you know, you are still making some interventions, and people do recognize, or people are moved, or kind of, you know, just kind of they really take to your work and your ideas, and that makes a massive difference. And you actually then start realizing again and building yourself back up for the importance of the struggle beyond academia, and it allows you to kind of think outside of this narrow space. And I think that's a really important message, that it's not about validation from these institutions. In whatever workplace you're in, we don't need validation from these places as people of colour, actually, because we can validate each other. And that, for me, is like the heart of all of this work that we do, is to uplift each other and the communities.
Katy, thank you so much for joining us. Really well done on this. It was very needed. And best of luck with all the forthcoming projects and events. Thank you to everyone for joining us. And you will be able to buy Katy's book online at our online bookshop, shop.ihrc.org. Thank you for tuning in, and join us next time. Thank you. For